Hello everyone, my name is Luc Aben, I'm chief economist at Van Lanschot Kempen. In this session, I would like to talk about the economic environment in the post-corona period. I'll start with a brief historical overview and then turn to questions like what will be the dominant economic forces post-corona? What with the independency of central banks? Are we heading towards escalating inflation? And finally, I'll elaborate on some relevant questions for investors. But before we start looking to the future, it's useful to look back. This way, we can better place future changes. One of the most important economic financial trends in recent decades has been the structurally decreasing trend of inflation and interest rates. The impact on financial markets was very significant. Think of the high valuation of equities or the high returns on bonds. A brief reconstruction. Inflation rose strongly in the 70s for several reasons. Years of expansionary fiscal policy. In the post-war period, Keynesianism was the dominant economic movement. It advocates an active fiscal policy to steer the economy, loose in difficult times, restrictive in better ones. In practice, however, policymakers tend to forget the latter. Second element, the expansionary monetary policy of central banks. This was possible because of the collapse of the Bretton Woods system in 71. Under Bretton Woods, exchange rates were fixed, with the dollar directly linked and redeemable against gold. De facto, this put a brake on money creation and the quantity of money. The quantity of money depended on the quantity of gold, and with the collapse of this system, that brake disappeared and monetary policy could be considerably looser. Third element, the low confidence in central banks generated high inflation expectations. And finally, the oil shock. In 73, OPEC limited the supply of oil, resulting in a large price increase. Under the impetus of Fed chairman Paul Volcker, central banks began to raise policy rates from the end of the 70s to fight inflation. This led to an economic recession, but gradually inflation began to fall. Gradually, financial markets also gained more confidence in the decisiveness of central banks to monitor price stability. Inflation expectations fell. From the second half of the 80s onwards, the economic paradigm changed. World leaders such as Ronald Reagan of the United States and Margaret Thatcher of the UK advocated small government, deregulation and market liberalization. Increasing competition helped push inflation lower. Deregulation and liberalization also curtailed the power of trade unions, just as globalization did later on. In addition, the available labor force, the baby boomers, peaked. And these factors contributed to keeping wage increases in check and therefore inflationary pressures. The 90s were the years of the ICT revolution, which increased productivity, again inflation depressing. And with the introduction of the euro, countries lost the possibility to devalue their currency in order to enhance competitiveness. The subsequent lack of structural reforms in some countries to address this competitiveness contributed to the euro crisis and the ECB's loose monetary policy, that is, low interest rates. On December 11, 2001, China joined the World Trade Organization. Through its large reserves of cheap labor, the country became the factory hall of the world. It flooded that world with cheap products. And afterwards, the banking crisis, the global financial crisis, and euro crisis threatened to trigger a deflationary spiral from 2007-2008 onwards. Central banks responded by sharply lowering policy rates, setting up purchase programs, and providing cheap financing for banks. This cocktail of measures led to low long-term interest rates. Also for weaker countries, for instance, Italy, Spain or Portugal. So in different periods of the past decades, different forces were dominant. But the common feature is that they all brought both inflation and interest rates to lower levels. To describe these different time periods, we propose the following labels: the 80s, the years of the liberalization; the 90s, the years of the technologization; the years 2000, the years of the globalization; and the year 2010, the years of the monetization. So that was the past. What forces will dominate post-corona? Central banks reacted to the corona crisis as they reacted after the banking and euro crisis, lowering policy rates, expanding purchase programs, the quantitative easing, and cheap financing for banks. However, in the area of fiscal policy, the approach was fundamentally different. After the banking crisis, emphasis quickly returned to austerity. And also during the euro crisis that followed the banking crisis. Today, the approach is different. There is massive fiscal support for both household individuals and businesses. You could say that Keynes is back, an active role for government to revive the economy. Central banks' purchase programs allow governments to finance that more active role. And in connection with the latter, there is more and more debate on modern monetary theory, MMT. This is an economic monetary theory that says that governments of countries with their own currencies can always call on the central bank to print money. Government deficits are therefore always fundable. The core of MMT is that monetary financing is not a problem. In fact, it's an appropriate means of achieving, for instance, objectives such as full employment. And when too much printed money would derail inflation, MMT argues to counter this with tax increases. Strictly speaking, the current purchase programs are not monetary financing. After all, they work through the secondary market, the market for bonds issued earlier. There is no direct exchange of new bonds for cash between the Treasury and the central bank. But it goes without saying that even the current operations through the secondary market are de facto monetary financing. Nevertheless, there's a broad consensus among economists that a Keynesian policy is warranted currently. Yet, there's a great deal of debate. Not so much about giving this support, but rather about how long it should be maintained. There's a camp that advocates rebuilding financial buffers as soon as possible. But another camp advocates that as long as economic growth is not at full capacity, government should maintain sufficient stimulus in order to fully exploit the economic potential. The fact that higher public spending leads to higher budget deficits and rising debt shouldn't be a problem. In the end, this would pay for itself through higher economic growth. How could we view this discussion? Perhaps the next line of thought will be a starting point. Not every government expenditure is the same. Some expenditures can be described as government consumption, for instance, social expenditures, but others are rather investments, for instance, in infrastructure. Large-scale budget deficits, mainly due to consumption, are at risk of being unsustainable in the longer term. At some point, financial markets may lose confidence. On the other hand, deficits and debt because of investments increase the growth potential of an economy in the longer term. And if well planned, these will eventually yield both a social return and a financial return. Where, of course, it's not sure that the desired results will be achieved. Moreover, there's a debate about the extent to which governments should behave as entrepreneurs. Are they the most appropriate party to decide on which path to follow towards more productivity? So the distinction between public consumption and public investment is important. But even apart from that, are we not irresponsibly burdening future generations with debts that will have to be redeemed? Not necessarily. Governments rather refinance debt instead of redeem it. Old debts are paid off with new ones. Where there is a danger that this refinancing will have to be done on less favorable terms, higher interest rates. In particular, if financial markets rate the financial situation of the country as poor at the time of the refinancing. And the level of debt certainly is an important parameter in this judgment. Still, it remains to be seen whether this is the most important parameter. Ultimately, a country's business model may be more relevant, the extent to which the economy is competitive, dynamic, flexible. After all, in the end, there are three ways to control high debt levels: more growth, higher inflation, or default. The first option is by far preferable. And if slightly higher inflation is a result of economic growth, this factor can help too, whereas derailing inflation is obviously disruptive and affects savers. Default, in turn, undermines trust in a debtor and thus complicates its future financing conditions. But what does this all mean for central bank independence? As pointed out, central banks such as the US Federal Reserve or the European Central Bank significantly boosted their purchase in the event of the corona crisis. In the short term, therefore, the large financing needs of public authorities do not result in higher interest rates. Debt is parked, if you like, on the central bank's balance sheet. This interplay between governments and central banks raises questions about the independence of the central bank. In the euro area, the European treaty guarantees the independence of the ECB. And that treaty gives the ECB a single mandate to strive for price stability. And the central bank, on its turn, translates this mandate by aiming for inflation of just under 2%. Although this mandate seems to be strictly defined, practice shows that it can also be implemented in a much more flexible way. For instance, the ECB seized on the quantitative easing instrument, both in the euro crisis and in response to COVID-19, with the aim of keeping long-term interest rates low. Quantitative easing can be interpreted as a policy that strives for a certain level of inflation. After all, too high an interest rate is hampering economic dynamism and would make it more difficult to achieve the 2% target. However, there's the criticism that the ECB interprets its mandate very, maybe too broadly, with some suspicion that the real objective of the policy is just to keep interest rates levels low throughout the euro area. In any case, monetary financing is prohibited by the treaty. Monetary financing means that governments sell new bonds directly to the central bank. That is not happening right now. The ECB only buys bonds that are already circulating on the market, the secondary market. However, the question is whether this de facto does not amount to the same. In the end, the result is that governments can accumulate deficits and build up debts which, albeit through the detour of the secondary market, still end up on the ECB balance sheet. And technically, this has no limit. In theory, it can go on indefinitely. The ECB can create an infinite amount of money at the touch of a button, the so-called basic money, notes and coins in circulation and reserves on the reserve accounts held by financial institutions at the central bank. And the purchase programs run through the latter. The bond is on the asset side of the ECB balance sheet, and on the liability side, the new money is credited to the account of the selling financial institution. What does this all mean for inflation? Are we on our way to post-corona inflation? From the start of the quantitative easing programs following the banking and euro crisis, there have been fears that inflation would derail. That hasn't happened so far. In recent years, the concern has been too low inflation rather than too high. And various forces explain this. Among others, the digitization. In many sectors, traditional business models are shaken up by digitization. Globalization. Globalization and the ever-increasing liberalization of international trade allow companies to produce where it is cheapest. Aging. Retirement means a fall in income, so less spending space. Less demand in the economy means less inflationary pressures. On the other hand, we should mention that the final impact of an aging population on inflation can be double. For instance, a shortage of people on working age can eventually push wages higher. And finally, another factor is the decreased velocity of money. The massive monetary support from central banks after the grand financial crisis only partially flowed towards the real economy and lending. Many resources remained lingering in the financial system and mainly caused inflation in financial markets. For the coming years, in the future, other factors could lead to higher inflation. Too much liquidity, for instance, in relation to the production capacity of the economy. Liquidity that is supplied en masse by both a broad monetary policy and fiscal policy. A loss of confidence in the value of the money and the monetary system. Trust is the most important pillar of our monetary system. However, if the central bank creates basic money, it happens as a kind of deus ex machina, out of thin air, and therefore society or financial markets can lose confidence in that money. The confidence that the money is worth anything at all. Another word for this, inflation. Other factor, deglobalization. Globalization led to the internationalization of production and supply chains. Post-corona, there's an increasing possibility that countries or economic blocs, such as the European Union, or companies want to focus more heavily on production within their borders, to have more control over supply chains or for political reasons. And if the cost of production weighs less heavily on future strategic decisions, this can have a direct upward effect on inflation. And moreover, there's a potential indirect effect. Globalization stimulates the dissemination of knowledge, of technology, by sharing that technology or because more international competition forces companies to continue to innovate. Deglobalization has an inverse effect. And finally, the climate risk, the risk of the energy transition, for instance. Carbon taxes or the complete replacement of fossil infrastructure with a sustainable infrastructure are potentially inflationary. Finally, some post-corona questions for investors. We have already discussed some forces that determine the future inflation picture. It goes without saying that this inflation picture will become an important investment parameter. How can monetary policy be normalized again, both in terms of policy interest rates and the reduction reversal of quantitative easing? Central banks have been pumping liquidity into the financial system for some time, and past attempts to gradually withdraw these liquidities led to turbulences on financial markets. Scaling back the quantitative easing will be a delicate balancing act, which will have to be carried out very gradually. For example, in 2013, then Fed Chairman Ben Bernanke announced that he wanted to gradually reduce the volumes of the then purchase program. And promptly, this led to a sharp jump in bond yields worldwide, the so-called taper tantrum. In such a scenario of further anchoring quantitative easing in the normal toolkit of central banks, the likelihood of significantly higher long-term interest rates seems to decrease. Where we define significantly higher long-term interest rates as a level that is persistently at or above the structural growth path of an economy. Traditionally, economists consider interest rates equal to the structural nominal growth path of the economy to be the normal level of equilibrium. Deliberately and artificially keeping interest rates low to avoid jeopardizing the financing of governments is labeled financial repression. And this has a significant impact on savers and investors, for instance, pension funds or on valuations in financial markets. If interest rates remain low, the search for yield will continue. For example, from high-quality government bonds to investment-grade credits, or from investment-grade credits to high-yield bonds. And this search for yield threatens to lead some investors to an asset allocation that actually no longer fits their risk profile. In addition, the prices of financial assets can be pushed up to levels that do not sufficiently reflect their underlying risks. The fair value of assets like real estate, infrastructure, or equities comes down to the discounted current value of future cash flows. Maintaining relatively low interest rates has a major impact on this calculation. Valuation parameters, the multiples such as a price-to-earnings ratio in equities, can structurally remain at a higher level than their long-term average. The flip side of the coin is that a structurally higher PE ratio also means that there is little or less room to realize future return from multiple expansion. On top of that, not every sector on the equity market has been affected by Corona in the same way. Some even benefited. The technology sector, which benefited from work at home or online shopping, is a clear example. Sectors such as transport or recreation were obvious victims, as are certain segments of the real estate market. The question whether these trends also continue post-corona is an open one, and the answer may have important consequences for sectoral choices in investments. Shares in growth sectors, for instance technology, also benefited from falling and low interest rates. Growth stocks traditionally have higher multiple valuations and are highly sensitive to interest rates. After all, they count on a strong outlook for their future profit development. And in theory, the value of a stock amounts to the discounted value of these future profits. The lower the interest rate, the higher the outcome of this calculation. But this also applies the other way around. Rising interest rates or real interest rates make these shares vulnerable, especially given the current pricey valuation. Central banks. No central bank has a certain level for the exchange rate in its mandate, nor to keep the exchange rate low in order to stimulate the economy through exports. However, there is the possibility that a low exchange rate may be implicitly pursued, and this can lead to distortions on the foreign exchange market or increase volatility, resulting in economic shocks. At the beginning of this text, we described the 80s as the years of liberalization. For investors, this period also initiated the central place of maximum shareholder value, the philosophy that the sole purpose of a company should be to maximize value creation for shareholders. In recent years, however, this one-sided focus has been increasingly questioned. Companies need to consider more interests and stakeholders in their policies. Think of the increasing accent on ESG. Both monetary and political authorities played a central role in tackling the corona crisis. There's a real chance that this greater social and economic impact of governments will be maintained after COVID-19. So we talked about the past, we talked about the current environment and fiscal and monetary policy. We talked about inflation, central banks, and some important relevant items for investors. I hope it was useful to you. Maybe you enjoyed it even. But in any case, thank you for your attention.